right? So people might have come across HMMs in other contexts, right? And you might be wondering, what does he mean by saying it's a graphical model? But it is a graphical model, right? So here, I'll stick with a concrete example, right? So I'm going to have a sequence, right? So I'm going to have a sequence of random variables, right? I'm going to assume that it is Markov in the traditional sense. So what would that mean? Okay, so it's left to right. Okay, so that is the earliest point in time. Okay, so there's no time; it's just a sequence, right? Just the first element in the sequence. Okay, and the second element in the sequence, the third element in the sequence, and because it's Markov, so this will be dependent only on the previous one, right? This will be dependent only on the previous one. So knowing this value makes this independent of anything that came before, right? So this is essentially the graphical model version of Markov, right? Just have a chain directed graph. So this is sometimes called a left to right model. Okay, simple left to right model. So this is the Markov part, right? I am also going to assume that I have a set of observations that I make, right? This could be like the pixels we are talking about, right? So I am having labels for the images, right? Labels for each pixel and the actual pixel value, right? So likewise in the hidden Markov model, so I will have random variables which could be labels, right? So these are labels, right? And these are the entities that are being labeled. So give an example of such a situation you will find. The video is a little tricky because you also have the spatial dimension to it, right? So text, that's why I asked how many of you are in NLP and are awake. So text, right? So I might want to do, say, part of speech tagging, right? I want to take each word, okay, and I want to assign a part of speech to the word, right? Or I want to assign each word, I want to take each word and I want to say that whether the word is part of a phrase or not part of a phrase, right? For example, I would need to figure out the United States of America is actually a single thing. Or the United States of America is a single phrase, right? So sometimes I want to capture things like that from the text, right? Is there some way of doing this automatically, right? So people have actually come up with ways of doing this. There are many, many things. There are tasks in NLP called chunking. So people have come across chunking? No? Okay. So chunking essentially says that, okay, I'm going to take a piece of text, right, and break it up into some meaningful chunks, right? It could be noun phrases, verb phrases, whatever, right? So, but some chunks, right? So that's called chunking, right? And there's another task called shallow parsing, right? So shallow parsing essentially breaks it up into phrases, right? But doesn't look at the structure of the phrases, right? I just want to give the phrasal structure of the sentence. So there are many, many tasks in which people do this, right? So, so people use hidden Markov models a lot in text, right? And the other place where people use hidden Markov models a lot is in speech, right? Because speech is inherently like a forward process, right? So speech is inherently a forward process. So people use that a lot in speech, and of course you can use it in videos. Except that your individual random variable will now become, I mean, something that covers the entire spatial dimension. So it becomes a little more complex hidden Markov model, right? So great. So I'm going to call these after that as XS.
Sir, in NLP context, what are the entities and what are the labels?
Well, these are words, right? These could be words, and these could be whatever label you want to assign to them. You can say that, okay. So is it part of a chunk or not part of a chunk, or is it part of a name or not part of a name? So I could do all kinds of labels I want on this. Because that's
the
assumption we are making to make the model easy. Okay, so yeah, we can relax this assumption. There are models that more complex models that do this. Specifically, the conditional random field that I mentioned when I was talking about Markov random fields, it relaxes the assumption of this dependence. Right, so this Markov assumption is still there, right? But this dependence is relaxed. So that is typically what you are looking for. I can look at any word in the sentence and then I can label the seventh word. Right, so that is, that assumption is that's relaxed. Right now I have to look at only the seventh word and the sixth label. I can't look at the sixth word. I have to look at the sixth label and the seventh word, right? And that's all the information I have. Right? So one thing to note here is the hidden Markov model essentially says that your xi gives rise to the yi, right? Doesn't go the other way. Okay. In fact, this also gives rise to a lot of problems later on. So the x's are essentially your labels. So you don't know the labels. You don't see the labels. But whatever you don't see, right, that part of it is Markov. Okay. And whatever you see is are the labels. Okay. And they are just give influence only by the whatever you see are the words, right? And they are influenced only by the labels. That is the assumption you are making. So this is very strong independence assumptions, right? But it turns out that it works like naive Bayes works, right? So this also works in many situations, right? But then of course it also doesn't work in a lot of situations, so people have come up with other models. I just wanted to introduce you to HMMs.
What is hidden?
Yeah, I don't get to see H1, X1, X2, X3. Right, I only get to see Y1, Y2, Y3, and X1, X2, X3 I'll have to guess. Right? I mean, you can also think of this as a hidden Markov random field if you want, but they don't use the terminology. But hidden Markov models is something that's used quite often. And there are inference techniques which people have specially honed for HMMs, right? But it turns out that the same things work on many of the graphical models that you will see. I mean, you will see in practice, right? So they have all kinds of things. They have an algorithm called the Viterbi algorithm, which essentially tells you what is the probability of the labels given the text. No, it doesn't give you the probability of the labels given the text. It gives you the map estimate, right? It gives you the most probable label sequence given the text. Okay. But then I can use it on any kind of this kind of inference process, right? So I can use the Viterbi algorithm for any kind of map inference process. Right? Instead of looking at the probability distribution over x, right? If I want to answer the query, which is the most probable configuration over x, right? This is the map estimate, right? We looked at that, right? Maximum likelihood map. And then the full Bayesian inference, which gives me the full distribution, right? So far we have been talking about knowing the full distribution, but you also want to do the map query, right? So that's essentially what Viterbi will give you. Give that, right? So we're talking about estimating a potential between xi and yi, right? So we're talking about estimating a potential between xi and yi. So the question is psi of xi yi independent of I? Regardless of where in the pixel the label occurs, right? Sorry, where in the picture the label occurs, right? Is the relationship between the pixel and the label the same? Right? When I say that the psi is independent of I, that's what it means. Right? That need not be the case, right? So suppose on the edge, if a particular pixel value occurs, it might have a higher probability of being a background, right? I mean, it's very edge. I mean, you're typically not going to frame a picture so that the foreground goes to the very edge, right? But then that might happen. But the problem is, suppose I have a 256 cross 256 image, then I have to learn a classifier for every one of those positions. I have to learn a classifier that gives me the probability of xi given yi for every one of those positions. Right? That's a very, very large problem, right? It's a very hard problem. So what we typically assume that psi of xi yi is independent of I. So I'm going to estimate the same model across the entire image, right? So of course you can try to be more clever. I mean, if you know some things about the task, you can be try to be more clever and say that okay, I'm going to break it up into four classes of size, okay, for x and y. I'll break it into four classes. I'll use one class here, one class here, rather than the bulk of the image and so on and so forth. So you can do things like that. But but typically without any prior knowledge, you just assume that it's the same all through. This has to be different, right? If that's also the same all through, then you're basically, we can use one pixel and predict the whole image, the label for the whole image, right?
Yeah. Psi of xi and its neighbor, that can also be the same, right? Throughout the lattice.
Do we end up doing that? You could do that also, yeah. Psi of xi, xi, xi plus 1, right, whatever. That could also be taken as being independent of I. you lose more modeling freedom that way, but you could do it that way as well. Yeah, it depends on how much effort you want to spend in doing the building the model. Yeah.